I've ditched my Intel MacBooks for the M1 MacBook Air for the last 3 or 4 weeks, but how does it perform and should you go for it? Hello everyone, my name's Mike and here at Tech Car Moon, we uncover tech at home and in video. So hit that subscribe button if you wanna see more. But today I'm gonna tell you my thoughts after about 3 or 4 weeks of using the M1 MacBook Air and should you forget about getting the Pro if you really are a Pro. First, let's talk about what's the same. Yes, it has the same 2560 by 1600 13.3 inch screen, but now features wide P3 color, meaning it can display more colors than your standard screen, and especially compared to the old model as well, and now matches up to the MacBook Pro, meaning it's great for color grading work, and even though it only has 400 nits of brightness compared to the 500 nits of brightness on the Pro, this difference is only noticed when working in outdoors or in a brightly lit room. For most color grading work though, you normally don't set your brightness to 100%, so it's not really been an issue for me working with the M1 MacBook Air. The Magic Keyboard is great, and it's even better with the MacBook Air because the Air's slanted shape means it's a very nice experience to type on, more so than the MacBook Pro, which has its sharp edges that can kind of dig into your palms in pretty much all angles. It's the same keyboard as we saw last year and provides enough travel for most and gives a satisfying click. I really love this keyboard. It is one of my favorites since they introduced it. The trackpad is as large as always, but not as large as the M1 MacBook Pro. It's not a huge difference, but it is noticeable side by side. When I was switching between the Air and the Pro though, it didn't really make a big difference, but I guess bigger is better. The webcam and microphones are good enough for video calls, as Apple did update the image signal processing of the 720p camera in this. It's a shame we don't see a bump in resolution to 1080p, as that would have helped with the overall sharpness, but I did notice a difference from the old model. But here's a test so that you can make your own mind up about it. Here we have the M1 MacBook Air, and this is the base model with the 7-core GPU and obviously 8-core CPU, and this is what the microphone is like from the 720p camera with the new ISP, so the image signaling processor, and hopefully it's a bit of an improvement from the old Intel models. The Air is lighter than the Pro by 110 grams, which may not sound like a lot, but I have gravitated towards the Air more for everyday tasks like writing documents and scripts and sorting my accounts and general web browsing because of the, you know, slight difference in weight. In terms of size though, they're almost identical. The Air has a wedge shape, whereas the Pro has more of an industrial square design. Now, I won't get into benchmarks because with a MacBook like this, even though we may see better raw numbers than a lot of Intel MacBooks, it's more important to see how it performs with software and with apps currently not optimized for M1 as well as optimized for M1. And even when apps claim that they're optimized for M1, it doesn't mean that they're fully optimized. It just means that they take better advantage of the hardware than running through Rosetta 2. I think, in my opinion, it's gonna take at least 6 to 12 months to see the true optimizations in most apps, I think. Now, I would normally do a fan test during different situations and different fan speeds, but the MacBook Air now doesn't have a fan. It's completely silent. But here is a speaker test for those who are interested in how that performs. So now, let's get into how this handles real-world tasks, and should you go for this model, what configuration you should consider, and would I go for this over the MacBook Pro? In the real world, the battery life on this thing is awesome. It definitely got me through the whole day, no problem. It lasted around 10 to 12 hours of my casual use. So things like using Chrome with sort of 10 to 12 tabs, with video playing and setting the screen brightness to around 80%. It worked really well. And in heavy tasks, on just battery alone, got around half of that. And I do some pretty heavy tasks, so this was really good in my eyes. If I'm completely honest, it was a bit hard for me to tell the difference between the MacBook Air and the MacBook Pro. I know that I got about an extra hour of real work use on the Pro compared to the Air, but the times are just so long for my kind of work that honestly, it didn't make a huge difference which one I used the most. So let's get into the recommendations. Firstly, let's talk about the student, casual user, and office worker. If you are someone who uses applications like Microsoft Office, Zoom, Chrome, and does a lot of multitasking with all of them combined, then the MacBook Air is actually a great choice over the Pro for the money. It doesn't get hot, and the 8 GB of unified memory works fine with this. And once applications become more optimized, I think we'll see better management of unified memory, meaning less usage with the same workload. If you are someone who runs an external display that is 1440p or higher, then I would recommend getting the 16 GB with the same workload. If you are running a 1080p display, then 8 GB works absolutely fine for me. If you are someone who mainly works with Xcode, then this would be a great Mac to go for, and I would actually recommend you upgrade the unified memory to 16 GB if you work with very large files, as there was a noticeable difference between the 8 GB and 16 GB. I would actually go for the Air with 16 GB of unified memory over the Pro with 16 GB of memory, as the price to performance just isn't worth it in my opinion. If you work in other programs like Android Studio, Homebrew, heavy users have sort of experienced issues, so I wouldn't recommend getting the Air or Pro for this kind of work. I would recommend you wait and see these get optimized, and I would actually go for a Razer laptop or a Dell XPS or even a used Intel MacBook Pro 16-inch if you need to get something now. I will leave a link in the description down below to help you figure out which applications work with Apple Silicon if you are a coder, as well as anyone else who wants to check if their applications work, as there are nearly 300 applications that have been tested with the M1 Apple Silicon, and there's even performance reports, so even if it runs through Rosetta 2 absolutely fine, they even tell you what it's actually like and if it actually does work fine through Rosetta 2. If you are a gamer, I wouldn't buy the M1 MacBook Air or Pro right now. Not because it doesn't perform well, but just because not a lot of games are compatible with this thing yet. You might say that I'm going against what people are saying about this M1 MacBook, but I've generally tried to install a whole bunch of games and it just didn't work, or it didn't work well. Plus, iOS and iPad games on the Mac right now are just rubbish. It doesn't feel right to play those games without a touchscreen, and yes, you could play those games with a controller, but you can't play it full screen, weirdly enough, so you might as well just keep playing it on your iPad or buy an iPad for those games. If you do play games like Minecraft or League of Legends and even World of Warcraft, they actually play better than the Intel versions, but I wouldn't ditch the Intel MacBook for the gaming experience on the M1s. For video editors, I'm actually going to split you into two categories: the casual user and YouTube video editor, and then the professional video editor who works with 6 and 8K files. If you are in the first category, so if you edit a YouTube video that is no more complex than the videos that you've seen from my channel, or similar channels who might post a video once a week at the most, or for someone who wants to get into video editing, then the M1 MacBook Air would be the best choice for you in terms of price to performance anyway. Yes, the M1 MacBook Air does throttle, but if you work with 4K H.264 or H.265 files up to 60 frames per second, or any kind of 1080p video, then the base MacBook Air is going to be enough for you. The reason I say this is that you're not really pushing the laptop hard enough for long periods of time. I mean, I edit these videos in about sort of, you know, 3 to 6, 7 hours, depending on obviously how long the video is. And the render times are normally around sort of 15-ish minutes. And I normally post a video once a week. And this, to be honest, this kind of workload isn't going to affect the MacBook Air and isn't going to have a long-lasting effect, in my opinion. And even though the Apple CPU does throttle down to keep the thermals at bay, you only see about a 10% performance drop, which honestly, with short edits like mine, just aren't noticeable, even with 4K 10-bit H.265 files. Now, I will say that if you are someone who likes to edit videos like I've just mentioned, and also have a lot of Chrome tabs running in the background, or like to multitask while it's sort of rendering in the background, then I would actually upgrade the unified memory to 16 gigabytes, just because you'll benefit more from having the upgraded unified memory than, let's say, going for the base M1 MacBook Pro for almost the same price. If you are a professional video editor who is looking to edit 6 or 8K video from, let's say, a Blackmagic camera, as they're relatively affordable, or even an A7S III 4K 120 frames per second video, then I would definitely go for the 16-inch MacBook Pro if you really want to get an M1 MacBook. Otherwise, I actually wouldn't recommend you getting either models, as we're just months away from Apple giving us a higher-end MacBook Pro 14-inch model with 4 ports as well, which is going to have obviously better performance, and in about 6 to 9 months we'll see an Apple Silicon 16-inch MacBook Pro, which will literally blow almost every MacBook Pro that we've ever seen out of the water. I will say this though, if you are someone who is looking to keep their MacBook for more than 5 or 6 years in any task you do, and you are just going to go for either one of these models, if you can afford it, get the 16 gigabytes of unified memory. This is less important if you're sort of the casual Chrome and Zoom call user, but for everyone else, this makes sure that your M1 MacBook Air lasts. On a side note, if you are someone who uses Microsoft applications like Inventor or SolidWorks, and were hoping to run it in virtualization, you are currently out of luck, as the two major players in this space are still working on their virtualization applications to work with the Apple Silicon chips. Also, I wouldn't know how well they will perform, and if you are going to be running either one of these applications, my recommendation would just be to go for a Windows computer, as I know SolidWorks personally works better with a Windows machine than a MacBook in Bootcamp, and definitely through virtualization anyway. And just to let you know, Bootcamp doesn't work with Apple Silicon, so if you are someone who runs Bootcamp on your Mac right now and uses this software, then I would say give it a miss. And in my opinion, I just don't think that we'll see better performance with virtualization as we did with Apple Silicon. In my opinion, I think that the best value M1 MacBook right now is the 16GB M1 MacBook Air. I think that this gives the best bang for buck that will last you for years. I think that if you really want a Pro and then you want to start upgrading bits, I then would start to question if you're not better off waiting and seeing what Apple brings next year, especially with a 4-port MacBook that's definitely going to be getting a redesign with even better Apple Silicon performance. Now, I have to say this, but if you are someone who is a true professional who maybe has an iMac 27-inch or a 15-inch or 16-inch MacBook Pro, then you are not the person that this MacBook was targeted for. These are entry-level MacBooks, and I would wait for the £1,800 14-inch MacBook Pro if you want something that is extremely portable but with the same Pro performance level as, let's say, the 16-inch MacBook Pro, as it's going to have a faster GPU, a faster CPU, obviously that 14-inch screen will be really nice, and obviously 4 ports for all the accessories that you might need. I genuinely think that that 14-inch MacBook Pro would probably be an Intel 16-inch MacBook Pro killer, in my opinion, and if you need the bigger screen and even more performance, then again, just wait for the 16-inch to be updated with Apple Silicon, as that machine could possibly be the best machine for someone who docks their MacBook and does a lot of heavy tasks, and then needs that portability on the go too. I honestly am excited for Apple Silicon to come to every Mac. If we saw Intel chips inside these MacBooks, we definitely wouldn't see this kind of performance, and we would still be seeing thermal performance issues. For me, it is impressive that the MacBook Air honestly is a very, very capable machine now. This beats a lot of sort of mid-sized laptops in terms of performance, which again is crazy. And in the ultralight sector, yeah, I genuinely think that this blows pretty much everything out of the water and does it with no fan. Those 11th gen Intels that we've seen for Windows machines, even when you're pushing them, let's say running them through Cinebench and all of that stuff, those fans are blasting out and they get lower performance than this fanless MacBook Air. That is pretty incredible. Now, the reason why I think that this is a fantastic machine is because this is the same chip as what we've seen in the MacBook Pro base model. Now, this is the first time we've seen that because normally the Air gets a much weaker processor than what's found in the MacBook Pro. Now, of course, the base model only has a 7-core GPU, but in the real world, it didn't make that much of a difference. But those are my thoughts. And as always, this is a discussion. So please leave a comment down below on what you think. And also check out the links in the description to support the channel. If you haven't already, please follow me on Twitter and Instagram at TechCarMoon. Drop me a like on this video if you've enjoyed it and hit that subscribe button if you want to see more. And if you want to see more from me right now, you know what to do. There's two fantastic videos just over here, one here and one about here. So click on those, go watch it, like it. You know what to do. Anyway, everyone, we'll see you in the next one. Bye.